thank you for listening to the BJJ Brick Podcast. We'll be bringing you Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu and good times. We hope to flatten your Jiu-Jitsu learning curve, help you get the most out of your grappling ability, and meet your goals both on and off the mat.
Welcome back, my friends, to episode 53 of the BJJ Brick Podcast. This is Byron. I'm here with Gary.
How's everybody doing today?
I hope they're doing great.
Definitely.
We're happy to be in your ear, sharing our jiu-jitsu thoughts with you today.
Yep, and like we said, last week was our one-year anniversary of the podcast. We appreciate all our loyal listeners and all our new listeners, and we hope we've been doing a good job.
Yep, it was a fun year, and yeah. Going strong, I think.
Yeah, definitely a strong year, and actually, this last Monday, the day we put out our anniversary podcast, we had a special occasion happening.
Yeah, what was that, Gary?
You know, I'd like everybody to know you are now. We now have a black belt on the podcast. Byron got his black belt on Monday there on our 1 year anniversary. So it was awesome to witness it. It was awesome to be his training partner since day one. I've been training with you since the first day you stepped on the mat. So I'm privileged to be his training partner. I'm privileged to watch him go from a white belt to a black belt. I'm privileged to learn from him. And congratulations,
and
Byron.
Teach me.
Yeah. Congratulations, buddy.
Thank you, Gary. Yep. So today's show, we had a guest kind of fall through, and we'll get him back on next week. So maybe the week after that, we're not sure. But Gary's idea was to interview me. I think it's going to be kind of weird, but we'll do it.
Yeah, definitely. You know, Byron's got a ton of experience. He's a brand new black belt, and I get to have the privilege of interviewing him for the first time.
Yeah, so I don't know. I think we're going to kind of do our standard interview template, but I think he's got some tricks up for me, so that'll be fun.
Actually, I'm going to keep this normal,
oh,
just
come
so
on.
Byron doesn't choke me out across the desk here.
So let's get on with the we'll talk more about, the last week.
Yeah, we'll talk more. You know, we do have a great interview today,
as
we talked about earlier, and we'll get to that here shortly, but definitely stay tuned for my interview with Black Belt Byron Jabara.
Yay. All right. Well, it's like, it'll be all right. I'm trying to still wrap my mind around interviewing.
Yeah, Byron, I don't think really feels comfortable being interviewed. And you know, I was like, hey, Byron, you spend a lot of time on the mat. You've taught a lot of people. You know your craft. You blood, sweat, and tears you left on that match. So, and I'm happy to, I really am. You've taught me so much in the years that I've been training. You know, you probably taught me more than anybody I know. You and Jake Fox are probably one and two, and John Castillo have taught me so much. And even though you've never been my instructor, we've been training partners,
yeah,
and you've always taught me, and I've always considered you my instructor. So, perfect.
Okay, well, let's before I feel any more awkward, let's go to the quote, Gary.
Don't you see me winking at you? Quote of the week. What do we got?
We've got Sam Walton, who, you know, now
he's kind of successful.
Now that
guy.
You're interviewing me, it's nice to have a quote from somebody who I feel like I can maybe tap out, even though he's not with us anymore.
Yeah, but I guarantee you, though, Sam Walton could pay somebody to tap you out.
Oh yeah, I mean, he'd pay you to do it. I hope you would take that money. So if you don't know, Sam Walton is the guy that started Walmart and Sam's Club.
Walmart and Sam's Club, definitely.
So, kind of some big money behind those two companies. His quote, high expectations are the key to everything.
That is true. I mean, you've got to dream big. I'm not going to, you know, everything I do, I want to be the best at. I want to, if your mind hasn't went there, if you haven't told yourself, I'm going to do this, do that, you know, with a high expectation, you're just going to not get there.
I think that, you know, when you look at Sam Walton, like a standard in the business field, a lot of his high expectations were for other people.
Yeah, definitely.
And he held everybody that I might have read one of his books or two, you know, in college. I don't remember him in particular, but you know that the people he worked with, he held to a high standard.
Definitely. And, you know, Byron and I were kind of talking about our podcast. When Byron came to me a little over a year ago and said, hey, you want to join in on my podcast? And first I said, what's a podcast? And then secondly, you know, I said, yes. But I remember Byron said, hey, my goal is to put out an episode every week. To be honest, I don't know what I'm doing or anything, but Byron jumped in, went right to that middle of the lake, both feet in there, treaded water, figured it out, and every single week has put out a podcast on Monday. That was his goal. He set a lofty goal, and it's happened. And even like today, we said we've kind of one of our the guy we were going to interview had other obligations, and something came up, so we couldn't do it. So we
got to get
a
show.
Yeah, that's our expectation. When we say we're going to do something, we do it.
Yeah. And that's, I mean, go back to the quote with Sam Walton, like, high expectations are the key to everything. You could have high expectations for your training partners. Your coach might have high expectations for you. Like, imagine if your coach did not have high expectations for you. Like, he just kind of views you as a regular person. And, you know, to be honest, a lot of people are regular people. But, like, if you want to kick it up a notch and, hey, I want to go compete. I want to do well. I want to go out there and really showcase my jiu-jitsu. And your coach has no expectations of you being able to do this.
Yeah.
That affects you.
Yeah, definitely.
That's not just a personal thing. That's a leadership thing as well. Like, expectations on people affect them.
Yeah. You know, and, like, I have expectations for my kids. You know, my son's a wrestler. My expectation isn't necessarily for him to win a state championship or this and that. My expectation is for my son to be respectful, be a good person, treat everybody with respect and courtesy. And really, I've set a high expectation. I want him to do that. It's a, you know, so it doesn't necessarily just have to be a jiu-jitsu expectation. It doesn't have to be a work expectation. Mine is a character trait, you know, for my son. And to be honest, I want to be hopefully I'm a good father. That's my expectation.
People do live up to the expectations that people set for each other. Yeah. People like, when I didn't do as good in school on some classes, I didn't expect to do that well. I'm not good at this category. My parents knew I was going to struggle at this. Well, as long as I can get a passing grade, that expectation was met. They weren't expecting me to make straight A's. If they did, maybe I would have.
Yeah,
maybe I wouldn't have, but maybe I would have tried. Doing,
instead of the Sam Walton's quote, maybe it'd be the Byron Jabara quote.
Oh, man. I'm a little ways away from that, I think, Gary.
Yeah, I think we all are.
So if you're in business school or you're looking for an interesting person to read about, Sam Walton's a good guy to go with.
Sam Walton.
So
definitely. He's the man.
He did some amazing things with business.
Definitely.
Gary, let's leave that little pond of our quote there and then head over to the
bigger lake, to the bigger pond.
I don't know. I started that without having a way to end it. So
yeah, I think we'll go to the little bit bigger pond, which we call the article of the week.
Okay.
What do we got this week, Byron?
We've got Andrew Smith wrote this for infobarrel.com. 3 ways to become happier with your Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu training. And I thought this was kind of a neat one to have, especially with if we're talking to me today, because that's a big theme that I like to, like, if you're new to the podcast, I'm not a world champion grappler. I'm not a step down from that. I'm just like a guy that likes to grapple. Yeah. And that is fun.
You know what I liked when you gave your black belt speech right after you got your black belt?
Yeah.
And you were talking to everybody that came, and you said something about you have to have fun.
Did I?
Yeah, you said you have to. This is jiu-jitsu. You need to have fun. And I thought that was awesome. And sometimes I think, I mean, everybody's different. Somebody who wants to be a world champion is going to put in a ton of work. It's going to be really rough. And I mean, not that saying the way me and you train isn't rough, but I don't know. I don't think I would train if I wasn't having fun.
Absolutely.
I'm not here to be a world champion. I'm here to have fun.
I tell people when they start, when a friend starts, they'll say, try to have fun. If it's not fun, it's going to be miserable. Like, it's one or the other. You're not like, oh, it's okay. Like, no, this guy is choking me.
Yeah.
And if I can't find a way to make that fun, it's miserable.
It's miserable. I like you put up a little poster, a meme or whatever on the website the other day about something about jiu-jitsu, you need to become comfortable in uncomfortable positions.
Yeah.
And really, that's if you can't become comfortable in an uncomfortable position, it's not going to be fun. You're getting smashed. But I kind of look at it, it's like I'm in a solving a Rubik's Cube, or I'm lost in a maze, and you're trying to find these way outs. It's a, you know, it works my brain, it works my heart, it works my muscles, and the whole time I'm smiling, even if I'm getting choked out.
Yep, you gotta have a good time, and even like you're saying, even when Gary gets tapped out, he is not grumpy, he's not mad, he continues to have fun. The article, I don't know if I mentioned, written by Andrew Smith, and he is also one of the guys that helps run the U.S. grappling circuit.
And I do see, especially, I see his those U.S. grappling tournaments all the time out there in like the Southeast. I see him listed on the Underground and on MMA.TV. So it's kind of neat because I've always seen those listed. Now we're looking at an article from one of the guys who runs that tournament.
He said he's been on the mat for about 17 years. He just feels like he has not mastered anything yet. That having been said, it's not simply becoming good. That's like the main thing. It's having fun.
Yeah.
So he's got three tips here.
You know, I like his first tip. Smile when you're rolling. And I'm telling you, just smiling can make a difference to everybody you meet. It really is. It's smiling when you're rolling. And, you know, it's like, it's not a street fight. It's just plain fun. That's exactly his exact words. It's plain fun. And it really is. Another thing I kind of got a kick out of, he said at his school there, a lot of times they play 80s music just to lighten up, get people laughing while they're training.
Yeah.
I think that's an awesome idea.
There was a long time ago, I think I was a blue belt. I did a tournament, and I put a picture of the tournament of me like grappling on maybe MySpace or wherever that was back then, and people started like thinking it was hilarious because I had like a killer mustache, like not just a little stash, but it was like a thick black mustache, and like all these comments about my mustache, I'm like, what are they talking about? Well, I was smiling and I had a mouthpiece in, it was black. my brother, he's like, and you know, back then it's like, it's a pretty poor quality digital picture anyway.
Yeah.
But my brother was like, dude, what's with the stash, man? That's a good one.
So I was
smiling. Yeah, I was smiling while I was rolling. Yeah. Even at,
hey, you were smiling. That deal. That's
yeah.
the key.
Maybe I was just breathing heavy, but right. I would say that I was smiling. The second tip here, Gary, what do we have?
We have slow down. You know, and like he says, this tip has a double meaning. First, literally slow down when you're rolling. You know, stop trying to win with speed. You know, use your technique. That's why we train jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
I tell you, it's great when you get a sweep and it's all technique. You know, you've got a big guy on top of you. You've kind of, you know, got his hips on top of yours. You've got him a little off-centered. And, you know, get that hook in, little nice sweep, and all technique. It's beautiful.
There. Yeah.
But, yeah, so, you know, just slow down. Don't go crazy.
Yeah, the second part of the slow down is to take some time off in between training sessions, he says. Learn to listen to your body. That's the other half of slow down. That's true. I mean, we've all been there.
Like, we were just talking about that a few minutes ago.
Yeah, you got it. When you're hurt, you need to take a few days off or a week or a month or, you know, even if you're...
And sister. Sometimes you may not even be hurt. I was telling Byron right now, man, I've got a broken toe. I've got two bad wrists. My neck hurts. And I just might need to take a couple days off just to relax my body a little bit.
That's in another way that you could slow down would be to pick the proper partner for how you're feeling that day. Like if you go in there and you're feeling like you're ready to win ADCC, you know, pick the right guy. Yeah. But if you're feeling like, you know, you got the busted toe like Gary today and he's basically sore all over, maybe pick somebody who will actually work with you a little bit better.
Pick the person who's got great technique and is working the same way you are. Not really just going crazy, just going to work technique-wise.
Yeah, this third tip here, Gary, we both gravitated towards, I think, is a real good one.
Definitely, set aside one training session a week to drill. And I think that goes back with what we were just talking about, too. First of all, it gives your body a little bit of a break where you're not taking the pounding. But secondly, it, you know, get your muscle memory, get you very good at the movements that you're drilling. While you're rolling, you're just going to hit it. You're not even going to think about it. Yeah. You're going to learn all the little ins and outs of that move that you can use to your advantage.
I do like how he said at the end of this little paragraph, he says, note, this is not figure out how to do a move time. That's for class. Like, this is time to drill the technique. You should know how to do the move. It should be getting your body to do the move correctly. Time, get your buddy. You know, this is how you make that. I mean, this is what me and Gary did. This is why we're good buddies, probably, because we did train specific moves for a long time with each other. Yeah. And I know Gary's game very well. And he, if I do something different, Gary's going to notice it almost immediately. Like, that's not part of your game.
And then I ask him to show it to me.
But he knows my game is as good as anybody out there. Like, and that's because we've drilled, you know, drill 5 minutes for what I want to work on and 5 minutes for Gary wants to work on and go back to me and go back to Gary. That way you're both learning what's interesting to you and you're being a good training partner as well. The last paragraph there, he said, above all else, make a conscious point to have fun while training. What's going to keep you coming back isn't some fear that of a self-defense scenario gone wrong or the dreams of winning the UFC, but the tremendous fun habit of training itself. Enjoy the journey, and I'll see you on the mats.
And I tell you, I like jiu-jitsu so much, there's nothing else I really want to do when I have free time. If I have free time, I want to train.
Yeah.
And it's because it's so fun. It really is. It's like going out and playing a game of pickup basketball or something of that sort for somebody who loves basketball. I like jiu-jitsu. I love to get out on the mat.
And I, you know, enjoy the journey. As somebody who just got their black belt a week ago, or actually today recording this is less than a week ago.
6 days ago.
Pretty shiny black belt. But I meant, you know, Andre had me give a little speech. And you know, it kind of was funny because I said, you know, kind of, I think I thanked everybody for coming, you know, because it was like, I don't know, 18-ish people on a Monday morning.
The crazy thing is, it was a Monday morning. When everybody should have been at work.
Yeah. So, I mean, that was really nice, you know, and, you know, they don't want to miss on Andre's training session either, so, but...
Byron, so give yourself credit. We kind of knew behind the scenes what was going on, and there was no way I was going to miss that.
That's
I don't
curious.
Care what my boss told me.
But I mentioned during my speech that I didn't even think about being a black belt until I was a brown belt. Like, literally... After that brown belt was around my waist, then I'm like, the next one's black. Like, I can't remember thinking about being a black belt before that time.
And I can tell you, because I've trained with you from day one, I really never heard you ever mention it at all.
Until it's just a thing.
I would bring it up after you became a brown. Like, I would bring it up to you every now and then, and you would say a couple words about it and then change the subject to something
but
else.
But it's not the reason I train.
Yeah, it's you have fun. It's a journey.
If there were no belts, if this was just like... like a hiking thing that we like to go hiking all the time. There's no belt in hiking. I'm still going to do it if I love it. Like,
well,
matter.
Actually, I have started a hiking man. System that what? I do have. But we don't have belts, but I'm going with backpacks, different colored backpacks,
different size of backpacks.
Yeah. Well, now I'm going with the colors. You know?
Yeah.
So I'm going with the white, the blue, the purple,
oh, you're still gonna
the
keep
brown,
the color
and
scheme?
The black. Yeah, I'm going to go with the same colors. So, you know, if you see somebody on that hiking trail with a black backpack, you better watch out.
You better watch out. The bears better watch out.
Yeah, the bears better watch out.
But it is about the journey.
Yeah, and
it's a cool article. I'd imagine if you're listening to the podcast about Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, you're having fun while you train. Like you're past the point of like, do I like this anymore? You're having a good time. Yeah. That's good.
Like I hope that some of us aren't rolling because our parents drop us off every day and we don't want to. But definitely we'll put a link to that article, Three Ways to Become Happier with Your Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu Training, and it's by Andrew Smith, and Andrew helps run the grappling tournament circuit called US Grappling.
Good stuff, guys. Oh, Gary, time for the awkward part, I guess.
Yeah. You know what time it is. It's the time that most people tune in for. It's our interview of the week. And this week, I get the pleasure of interviewing my co-host, the owner of BJJ Brick, Byron Jabal.
How did you arrange this big interview like this? I mean, it's amazing you were able to set this up, man.
I tell you, the guy's hard to get a hold of.
Many emails back and forth.
Yeah, he's hard to get a hold of.
Where did you email to get this guy?
He canceled on me 7 times.
How'd you get a hold of this guy's email? What's his email?
BJJBrick@gmail.com.
I threw that in there.
Look at that, a little advertising there.
Yeah, or if you want to get a hold of either one of us, that's a good way to do it.
Yeah, yep. But back to the serious part. We'll get serious.
Very serious time.
Yeah. You know, Byron, I know we've been on this podcast for a while, but, you know, introduce yourself to the listeners here.
Okay. My name is Byron Jabara. I am from Wichita, Kansas, born and raised. Been training jiu-jitsu basically right out of college, 2002, sometime in the spring, basically right when you graduate. That's my basic thing. I got a book by Gene Simcoe.
I remember the Gene Simcoe book. Yeah, he was big back then.
I had the scissor sweep in there.
Actually, the crazy thing is Byron had a scissor sweep really early in this game, and he'd kill us all with it. That's where you got it from.
Yeah, got it from a book. And then I figured out that I got the book before I started with John. I didn't even know he was in. This is before Google. Not that it's we're super old at jiu-jitsu, but I look in the Yelp pages, I didn't see jiu-jitsu. How do you find jiu-jitsu without Google?
Yeah, and I mean, back that was dial-up internet, and there wasn't all the stuff online either.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right now, you can just plug in,
there was on the
techniques.
Mac, or what was the website? There was one website that had the techniques, basically.
I used to go to AD Combat Club, or Abu Dhabi Combat Club. Yeah. That was my thing. ADC. That was, and crazy.
Yeah. So, started in 2002. I think it took us a couple of years to get to our blue belts. Me and Gary got blue belt the same day. Eric Williams. I do remember getting my blue belt with him. He was fun, and I really enjoyed his style. I've tried to – I can't get a hold of the guy. I want to get him on the show, but I can't even, get him to tell me no.
Yeah.
I don't have any contact information for him. I emailed his gym, but that was no luck. So if you know him in Houston there, you have him give me a call or – you shoot me his information. I'd like to get him on the show. Anyway, he gave us. So here, we're in a situation that's different, than most people today. Here we are in Wichita, Kansas. John Castillo was our instructor. He's a purple belt. And that was it. That was Gary, me.
There was no
6 or 7 other guys that are white belts.
There was no blue belts in town. Yeah. I mean, Jason Bercher. And
he's already moved by
then. Yeah, he'd come back every now and then.
Yeah.
And we looked at him as a god. Well, I still do. Chris Easter, same thing.
Yeah,
it's looked at him as a god. I remember those two guys helping us.
Yeah, but after a couple years of training, John's like, "You guys need a test for your belts." Eric Williams was going to be in town for family stuff anyway, so he came by and we met him and we tested that the same day or maybe the next, I don't remember, but it was basically, "Hey, this guy's awesome at jiu-jitsu," and he is, and he tested us. Do you remember what our test was like, man? Because I'm not going to forget my blue belt test.
Yeah, I remember the blue belt test.
He had us, he paired up, let's say there's probably...
There were six of us.
Six of us, so he paired us up kind of by size. We're all wearing white belts. He got two bigger guys together, two medium guys together, and me and Gary were together. And he motivated us to go hard. And
we had a death match.
Yeah, we did. I was trying to kill you, man, and I think you're doing the same. We really wanted to tap the guy out to show him that we're not bad at jiu-jitsu.
I remember right before we stepped on the mat, Byron kind of whispered to me. He's like, "Hey, Gary, go hard." It's like, I think he thought that because we're such good friends that I wouldn't go hard or something.
Yeah. Maybe, I don't remember that, but I've said that to – I rolled against a buddy of ours, D, at a tournament. And I go, I don't remember what it was. Either we go or we don't go, but if we go – go for it, man. We're not going to go out there and play around because, I don't know.
Yeah.
Whatever. Anyway, so, we was trying to murder each other for the 5 minutes or whatever. We were exhausted. And then he rolled with us and just, of course, just took us apart. And he asked us to show our best moves or something, and we did. And he told me, so I'm short of my arm bar, which is my best move by far. from guard. You remember that?
Yep. Man, Byron had, he'd kill me with that.
But I wasn't bringing my hips off the ground.
Yep, I remember him getting out of your hips.
I'm like, this is my best move. Like, if I can't even do this right, my first BJJ brick, my best move that I had, had some serious flaws in it. And he wanted to see some stuff from every position or whatever. And back then there was like, you know, six, you know, I didn't show anything from like deep half or any, you know.
Yeah, there was no deep half. There was no half card.
Not for us anyway.
Yeah. I never so heard of half card.
He
did.
He told me I had some serious holes in my game.
Well, he said the same thing to me because he talked to us both at the same time.
Yeah.
Like, he told us we had some serious flaws.
There goes getting our blue belt. But he ended up says, just work on him. He said, I'm going to give you guys your blue belt. You got some work to do. Here, you know, so that was cool. And then he threw us, and I think that's been a pretty standard thing for belts. Yeah. Purple belt, training with, so that was John Castillo. Still John Castillo, had Marcelo Silva moved into town and training with him a little bit. He wanted me to test my purple belt, and Roberto Tozzi was in town and tested with him. So another recurring theme here is I test under somebody different every time.
Like, yeah.
And that's because we live. That's in Wichita,
where we live. Like, yeah, it's tough.
Real tough.
You got to really love the sport. Yeah.
Yeah, and yet again, like here is this amazing grappler coming to town. Yeah, if I should test, I should test with him. You know, like this is cool. So kind of got beat up on that one. You know, that was purple belt's not an easy test. I don't know. Every test is different for every person, but that was good. And I got my purple belt after I don't know how many years. 3 or 4, I don't know how long I was blue.
Yeah.
But I was purple belt for a long time.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know, 7 years maybe? I don't remember. Did a lot of purple. And it's always funny as you get your belt, and I'm experiencing that now, like, it takes some getting used to.
Yeah.
Like, it's unusual. Like, Jake told me, like, Jake Fox, who's a black belt, he's like, it took me, like, a couple of times when you have, like, a bad day. Like, I'm a black belt. I'm having a bad day. Like, these guys are... Everybody in the gym is pretty good. Even those, like, some good white belts and some good blue belts. Like, I'm going to have a bad day, and my sweep's not going to work, and I'm going to get stuck in a position. And, like, he's like, you're a black belt. You're still going to have a bad day. It's nothing magic about the belt. Like, and he says, like, having that sting a couple times, and then it doesn't sting anymore like that same. Like, that's what it took for him. And I imagine something similar for me. Like, I know I'm going to have bad days. I mean, that's just how I, you know, I'm not like trying to peak at a certain time. I show up if I'm ready or not, you know, and I'm going to have fun. So I know there'll be bad days for me, but whatever, man. I mean,
it's everybody's going to have that. It does, you know.
Quite a while as purple belt. I should have researched it a little bit better. I know that I got pictures with dates on them, so I could probably figure it out. But eventually ended up with training with under Hanato for purple.
Hanato Tavares.
Yes. And after a while of training with him, it was time to test for Brown. Did a test, and it was funny. I had a couple of other guys testing with me that were getting their blue belts, and I don't know if I was nervous or not. You know, like, you know, you get Hanato is sometimes pretty intense guy. Like, and you're gonna get a test.
I mean, the guy's a legend.
So I know one of the blue belts is really nervous. And he goes, hey, guys, don't be nervous. Don't be nervous. Like, it's just a test. He goes, one mistake and you fail. It's like, dang it, man. And then he laughed. Like, oh.
Lighten the mood a little bit there.
Yeah, he's attention, guys. Just don't mess up at all. But so I got my brown belt under Hanato Tavares, who we've had on the show. And that was an honor. They have all been tremendous honors to
be part of. Yeah, anybody. We appreciate everybody that will.
And Andre's been like a theme in my jiu-jitsu for quite a while because I trained with John Castillo and Jake Fox would bring in Andre. So every seminar at Jake Fox's gym, I would go over there and get the Andre seminar. Sometimes Andre would teach a seminar at John's school. So like I've been training with Andre quite a while. Like it's been good.
And well, even before that though, me, you, and Jake Fox have trained together for years. Even when Fox, you know, went on his own and everything, we still were always great friends and helped each other out. And you know, Jake's always been there for me, for you, and so it's kind of a tight knit group. You know, we're tight knit friends, so it gave us other options to train there too.
Yeah, I think part of what made me. When I got my brown belt, Hanato told me, you were not going to spend as long at brown as you did at purple.
Yeah.
And that's kind of when I was like, I'm going to be a black belt someday. Like, like it did, like before, like I said, I didn't ever think about it. Like, yeah. It wasn't even on the radar. And then when he said that, it's like, man,
it's going to happen.
Like, as long as I don't like get too messed up at work or do something crazy, like I'm someday going to get this. Like, it's going to happen. So that was kind of neat. So the relationship was built more with Andre over time. And John, for one reason or another, you know, lost. I don't want to speak for the guy, but he lost the desire to own a school, to own his jiu-jitsu school. He likes jiu-jitsu,
yeah.
But he was tired of doing the business side of it. He'd been doing it since we started. I think he did it for over 10 years easily.
Yeah.
And he just lost the desire to own a school. He loves to train and to work out. So I ended up, John closed down. I ended up going to Jake Fox's, and then I got real, you know, regular instruction with Andre and stuff. So that was cool. And of course, Jake Smith, the Jakes,
yeah,
are there. They both had to earn their black belts. I don't know, while I was over there training with him.
Yeah.
So I had two regular black belts to train with. That helped a lot too. Before you know it, it's Monday morning. I don't know how long it was a brown belt. It wasn't, how long do you think it was? A couple years? Maybe a year and a half, two?
I'd say probably two.
Yeah. I was, like I said, purple belt was my long one, and I was fine with that.
Yeah.
A couple of unique things about me, maybe not unique, but I never got a stripe. Just never did, never, I guess I never, I don't know why. John wasn't big on stripes, and why change it at the brown belt level, I guess. So... But John did give some stripes out, but I just didn't really care about testing until they told me it was time to test.
Yeah.
And then I was getting a belt, not a stripe.
Yeah.
And there was no like regular set schedule. I'm gonna get a stripe at a certain time. Nah.
You showed up, put your work in, had fun.
Yeah. So that's kind of the no stripes is, I don't know if it's unusual or not, but it's part of what I did or did not have.
Yeah.
And I could see stripes. Like if I wanted to test my purple and I wasn't ready. A couple of stripes might be nice for motivation.
Yep.
So I could definitely understand why people get them and could feel that they're getting progress. But, so that's, well, man.
That's Byron. This would
be like the world longest interview about nothing to say. Yeah.
Well, I know we've probably talked about this before, but tell everybody what you do for a living there.
I'm a firefighter. So I mentioned this in my little speech. I'll get back to your question here, Gary, I promise. Okay. He's going to hold me like Barbara Walters to the hard questions. Andre had me give a little speech, which I, you know, it's easy to come up there and say, thanks for coming, guys. It was an honor to have been training with everybody. You know, I got my black belt today. Thank you. And then I kind of paused and I was done and nobody said anything. I'm like, shoot, man, I better say something. Like, I fill that silence with something. So I started talking and I got out of college. I didn't have any job set up and I was like, looking for a job, and I had like time to kill, and I was bored, so I started jiu-jitsu, and it was like a good like thing to do, like it's some rhythm to my day while I was looking for trying to find something I want to do with myself, and so the jiu-jitsu was there like right away, like right after college, and it was good, you know, get around such positive guys, you know, and do that sort of thing. Eventually, I started training at the police academy. Wasn't a police officer, but the firefighters were there training as well. And I talked to them a little bit, and one thing led to another, ended up becoming a firefighter.
Yeah.
And I would say I might not be a firefighter today if I wasn't in jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
That's not fair. I would not be a firefighter today if I didn't do jiu-jitsu. Yeah. That's the only fair way to say that.
I will add in a point that Byron didn't make here, but when we trained at the police academy there, it was all police officers, firefighters, and then Byron and I.
Yeah.
And the crazy thing was, like, those two sides, the police officer on one side and the firefighters on the other side, were fighting to see who would get Byron.
Yeah.
Like the police officers wanted him to. I know he did some ride-alongs with the police officers. And I'll never forget another guy we trained with who's actually been on the show, episode 9, as he says. Craig Kennedy, he was a paramedic, and he was on episode 9 about injuries and how to treat them on the mat. But I remember Craig said one time he showed up at a call. He is EMS, and he got a call, and as he showed up, he's like, there were two police officers that we trained with all the time, Bob Bachman and Dave Goodman, and he's like, riding along with them was Byron. And I remember Craig said, I never felt so safe you know, going into this house to try to deliver some first aid with those guys got my back.
That was pretty neat on a ride out and seeing, like, everybody I trained with. Like, I don't know if that had something to do with it. I probably thought about being a cop, but it just wasn't quite the right path for me. Like, I don't know.
Yeah.
But the fire guys started showing up, and that seemed to be interesting. And you know, if you're in a job that you like and people ask you questions about it, you should help them out and promote the and that's what they did for me.
And that's the great thing about this sport. We're not just going there to train. You build friends who help you along. And so I remember you know, back in the day, you even had an interview when I was working with Wells Fargo.
Gary got me an interview there.
Yeah, it's like, you know, that's what we do. We look out for each other. We try to help each other out.
Yeah.
It's kind of cool sport.
Yep.
Byron, can you describe your Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu style or game?
Oh, man. First, we were talking about this before we started, Gary. I train gi and no gi about the same amount of time. And I don't want to spend all of my gi time on like a lapel choke and then not be able to work on that on my gi days. So I don't really work. I used to do a lot of gi chokes and I used to do a lot of stuff with the lapel, but I don't anymore because I can't train it on my days that I'm in there with a no gi. So my BJJ, you know, with the gi on game is a lot like my no gi game. I don't mind playing on the bottom. I think I prefer passing at this point.
Byron, you are a very good passer, and when you pass, you have very good pressure.
I think one thing that I've done differently for my passing is I pass to my right, which throws people off because they're used to the passer passing to their left. I don't know. I get just as much fun out of passing as I do getting the submission. When I roll with a white belt, I don't say like there's a rule, but usually I kind of roll. I was talking to Jake to Fox about this the other day. I kind of roll down. Like I don't even try to roll not as hard. I just don't roll as good anymore. Like I'm rolling like a decent blue belt. Like, you know, like I kind of match their skill a little bit maybe, and I can't remember tapping the white belt out more than two times in 5 minutes. Like, unless there's something that needs to be done otherwise, like. A point to be made. I don't know. Yeah. Like, generally, two times is
less
quite a bit of time.
Less a point to be made.
I can't think of it. Like,
yeah. But, you know,
the only thing I get passionate and mad about when somebody's beating up on a kid or something, like in class, like, okay, this kid is not, or this person's on the first day, here you are kicking their butt all over the place. Okay, you're going to get tapped out if I could do it more than twice.
Yeah.
But otherwise, kind of a average pace, I would say. I don't mind pulling guard. I like to sweep. I used to like triangles a lot. I kind of got away from those. I do arm and guillotine from the guard a lot. Yeah.
What would you say your brick is?
Probably now is arm and guillotine.
Arm and guillotine.
Probably from the guard, and it's not as good with the gi on because it gets caught up.
Yeah, see, I'm the same way with my guillotines with a gi on. It's I have trouble because it gets caught up with the collar. Yeah.
I would say a few years ago I would have said triangle choke, but I've been stacked enough times and like it kind of bothers my lower back.
Yeah.
And then like I'm at work and my back is sore. Probably don't do a
triangle probably went
month
three.
Anymore.
You probably went from arm bar from the guard, even though your hips weren't raised high enough, and you went to triangle, and now arm and guillotine.
I've had a lot ones, like just even a year ago, I was doing arm triangles a lot from side control.
You were doing you were doing your north-south choke, and Byron is kind of the guy, one of the two guys, I guess, I trained with that are really known for wrist locks, too.
I do. So
when you roll with Byron, you better... know where your wrists are at.
Well, and I be careful because I tell the guys who are wrist lock is like, I don't make friends wrist locking people, so you're already my friend. Like, because if you don't know me and I wrist lock you, like, you're not going to be my friend. Like, so nobody likes wrist locks. Yeah. But I do.
I do. I like it when you throw wrist locks. Okay. Byron, what would you say your goals are in jiu-jitsu?
Just to keep having a good time. I don't think I have any competition goals at the moment.
Yeah.
I've competed. I did not compete as a brown belt, which was kind of maybe because it was a shorter belt for me because I didn't have like 6 years to do it. But I competed a decent amount of purple belt. I was a little worried about like not necessarily the competition, but the harder training and then having. It's funny because I need my body to go to my job. Like, yeah, I never thought of it like that until, like, I'm sore. I'm like, I can't do my job good today because my body hurts. Like, it's not like I'm not sending an email for a job anymore. Like, I have to be able to show up and do work.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, you've got, it's like same as a construction guy. Like, if you break his foot, he just can't work.
Yeah, yeah. You've got a, you know, family, job's number one.
Yeah.
So, totally.
So
totally
I'm a little nervous about not necessarily competing, but training for the competition. Because I know, I mean, that's hard on me too. But I'm basically have a good time training and getting better and helping those around me get better.
Yeah. And I will tell you, the last thing you said, helping those around getting better. And Byron's always been big at that. You know, like I said, he's helped me so much. You know, just a little thing here. He helped this lady not too long ago who was having trouble trying to pass a sheriff's academy for correctional officers. And Byron took the lady aside and actually helped her out a ton. And, you know, just seeing him give up, you know, his time of rolling. And really, I kind of looked at it like, oh, he's giving up time of rolling. But that's not Byron. Byron's always there to help people. So,
well,
you know, seeing that stuff.
That was an interesting case because, not to get off topic, but she was enrolled to become a detention officer, work at a prison or something like that. And she was in the class struggling to show any sort of authority or, like, even to protect herself. Like, she just struggled at the self-defense aspect of it. So brought her in and taught her some, like, aggression. Like, you know, you can't – said this grapple. And she really didn't understand it for about 5 minutes until she saw it. Push me around. Like, and then I haven't seen her for a while, but Gary's been working with her quite a bit.
Well, to be honest, you inspired me. You really did.
But she graduated her class just recently. That was really cool.
And that's the thing. Everybody helping each other out. But Byron really is passionate about that. And, you know, he's really passionate about having fun. You know, like, what advice, you know, we'll get to some coaching stuff here. You know, I know you don't have a school, but you do coach a lot of people, you know, people all look up for you. What advice would you have for somebody getting ready to go in their first tournament there?
To have fun. That's the main thing. I would do yourself a favor and not tell everybody that you know that you're going to win the tournament. Like, especially if it's your first one.
That can backfire.
Like, well, because there's, who knows how many guys in your bracket, they're all thinking the same thing. They all have been training. Like,
yeah.
To win a tournament, you need to be competing better than the other guys, and you don't know how good those other guys are. You could be coming in as a white belt, and there could be a guy who was ready for his blue belt. You know, he'll get his blue belt after he gets his medal. Like, that's a tough match to win. You could do it, but just say, hey, man, just, if you want to tell people I'm going to do a tournament, that's fine. A lot of tough guys in my bracket is what I'd recommend just tell people because, you know, if you do lose, and, you know, if there's 8 guys in your bracket, there's a 1 in 8 chance. Or no, you have a, I mean, only one guy out of those 8 is going to not lose. Like, that's really not good odds. But, I mean, so, and another thing I would say that I've always done at tournaments is to talk to the guys after you get done. And not everybody's going to be like all buddies with you, but if somebody actually taps you out or somebody, you know, really does a good job, take the time, introduce yourself to them, figure out where they train, and just talk to them. You know, it's kind of neat to figure out where these guys are coming from and what they think. Everybody's different, but they're just like you. Like, they're just trained. They were nervous stepping on the mat. They'll tell you that. And, like, just be like a nice guy. Come up to say, hey, where are you from? And it was fun rolling with you. You know, it was a slick arm bar or whatever.
Yeah.
Now, it's the exact opposite. If you destroy somebody in the first round or whatever, and it's a 30-second match, let them come up to you because you don't want to be like, hey, thanks for rolling with me. That was a sweet arm bar I did. But
I've had, be honest.
I think every time I've lost, I've managed to talk to the guy, and they've been cool.
Yeah, and you've made friends and learned new stuff.
Yeah, but have fun and don't big deal. It is your first tournament. You're not expected to come home with an easy gold.
Yeah, yeah. What would you say you were like as a blue belt there, Byron?
As a guard player, for sure.
Definitely.
I don't know. I don't think I liked playing guard a lot, but I just did because it was out of convenience and necessity. Trying to think about the guys we rolled with as a blue belt.
Yeah, we had some big people. Yeah.
And then I had you and me.
Yeah.
But,
and I will say, I used to get in your... I wouldn't want to be in your guard. Your guard was very aggressive and offensive.
I started as a blue belt better than it's so much different back then because I mean really as a blue belt then I'd get smoked by the blue belts now.
Like, oh yeah,
but I started to finally figure out some combinations that I liked. Like I'd try to like armbar somebody, they'd pull their arm out, and then I'd try to transition to a triangle real quick, and it was like, yeah, you know, like double up on some moves, you know. But you know, I think of blue belts nowadays, if they do that before they're blue belts, like most of the time anyway.
Like you said, the day when we started, especially in Wichita, Kansas, weren't a lot of higher belts, and plus there wasn't a lot of stuff on the internet.
Yeah, the knowledge sharing that online and that people that travel around and teach jiu-jitsu have been able to do for the sport has been huge.
Yeah.
So yeah. I don't know. I mean, I was just a regular guy. I didn't compete till I was blue belt, which was not by design. It was just because there was no tournaments competitions anywhere near.
Yeah.
So,
what tips would you have for some guys, for grapplers here to develop a game plan?
Game plan. Find what if you have like no good moves, you gotta start picking on the guys that are a little bit less skilled than you, or not as good as you, or maybe you know like somebody that actually tap out, like, and find out what is fun and what you have confidence in. I think that's big, is to have confidence in your technique. And then try to work that technique up to guys near your level, and then it will slowly get to your level, like you're a blue belt, and I occasionally get an armbar. Okay, I got a decent armbar. So I can armbar all the white belts and none of the blue belts. Well, eventually, if I keep armbarring the white belts and start trying to armbar the blue belts, eventually I'll start getting the blue belts. And then eventually that move is going to start working better on the purple belts. Yeah. And then everybody's going to know I have a really good armbar. Like, it's no secret, but I mean, that's the like a BJJ brick for you if you hone that technique. So, no technique that I ever, if I didn't have confidence in the technique when I started to like latch it in, or like, oh, this choke feels loose or whatever, it doesn't work. So like, if you feel like you don't have confidence in like, oh, my guillotine is weak or whatever, like, you're never going to get your arm around the back of their head and lock it up and finish somebody who's as good as you or better. Like, so that wouldn't be your good move. What move do you think you're good at? And work on that. Like, that way you at least have some confidence with it.
Yeah. Well, that's what I was going to ask you about there too. You said, what move do you think you're good at? And work on that. Do you think it's better for somebody to maybe have a brick move, you know, their move and work on that, especially when they're a beginner, you know, blue belt or below, you know, white belt? Or should they, you know, getting ready for a tournament or whatever, a game plan, or should they work on three or four different submissions? Or, you know what I mean? Would you put more time into your one that you're a little bit better at and just...
It depends what your brick would be. Like, okay, if my brick is triangle choke from guard, I still need to know how to pass somebody's guard, because if Gary, you pull guard on me, I've already lost the match. You don't even know that I can't get to the only move I've drilled for the past 3 months has been triangle choke from the guard, and Gary pull guard, I'm done.
Like,
so I need to know how to play some stuff, but I need to have that confidence in that technique that is like, I'm in my guard, or Gary's in my guard, I'm going to get this. Yeah. This guy's going to, he's already done. He has no idea my triangle's headed his way, and it's going to happen. So that's one example of like a brick. Now, if your brick is armbar from mount, that's a whole different deal, because you got to do so many things to get to that mount.
You've got to have the takedown, you've got to pass, you've got to solidify.
You're probably up on points even if that is your move. Yeah. Like, so.
That's a good point.
You need to have a good enough game to get from the position you are now to where you want to be to get your brick to throw, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
You don't have to have, like I always say, you don't have to have, like, I armbar people's right arms. I don't armbar the left arm. And that's up to me. But if you're going to armbar my left arm, I can defend it as good as I can defend my right. Like, your defense needs to be equal.
You can't, if not
have,
better.
You can't have a good side to defend. Like, you need to be ready to defend both.
Yeah. I never thought of it that way. That is true. It's most of our offense, we're better on one side.
Yeah.
But I look at my defense, I'm just as good on both sides, really.
And that's because, That's because you haven't had a choice.
The guys I'm rolling with are equal opportunity submission artists. They're going to take whatever I get them. But me offensively, I'm normally working on my brick side.
Equal opportunity submission artists. I feel like that should be like a thing. Like,
yeah, that's a... Let's
figure out like an acronym that actually sounds cool. With
yeah, let's get a patent for that word. you know, hey, going back, you know, you're talking about game plans and everything. What do you think would be a good goal for a student in his first year of jiu-jitsu? You know, it's like your first year, you're not going to win the world championship. What's a good goal for somebody to keep it fun and keep them training?
You know, I have an advantage in these questions because I've asked a lot of like guys who are way better than me.
Yeah.
At these. And one of the more interesting ones, and you know what sucks is I can't remember who says what.
Yeah.
Because I can't. That's not how my
You've been choked out too many times. Lost some brain cells.
But somebody said, depends on who the person is. Like, it's like asking what's a good food for somebody to eat. Like, well, everybody has different
I'll take some pizza.
Yeah. So it does depend on you. Like, is your goal weight loss? Is your goal... I would say the biggest goal would be to develop a passion for jiu-jitsu. If you could in a year, like make jiu-jitsu part of your lifestyle and you have a passion for it, you're going to be fit for life. Like that's what more could you ask for? Like there's no seasons to this sport. Like if you love basketball, well, you're going to play basketball during basketball season. And it's a little hard to get some guys together off season, or you know maybe it's not. But like there's no seasons. You if you're free this night and the gym's open, you're going to go roll. You're going to go train. And to be, it's like jogging is a good example. Like if you love jogging and you keep that passion throughout your life, you're going to be in shape for your entire life. Like there's no reason not to be. But I jog. Jogging's not like a roll. I don't get excited about it. It's okay. I take the dog with me, but but get her some exercise. But when I do jiu-jitsu, it's fun. Like I'm here and I would do jiu-jitsu if there was no exercise involved. Yeah. Like if it was a computer game and I got fat doing it, like I
really
still
is
do
a computer game. You know, it's a mind game.
So with no the fact that I get exercise is a benefit. Yeah. Like, and I think that's a big benefit that is often overlooked by everybody. Like, I'm going to be healthier. I'm healthier now than I would be without it, for sure. And I'll be healthier in 10, 20 years, or you know, however old
that's
I can't move anymore.
Yeah. You're talking about your passion for jiu-jitsu. When you first started, let's say in your first year, did you have the same passion as you do now?
I don't think so.
During your journey, was there times where your passion waned and you thought about quitting? Have you thought about ever hanging up out of the mats?
Not like I can't think of a day where it's like, this sucks, you know? But, you know, you get, sometimes you get disappointed. The first part of the question, was my passion the same? I don't think it was. I don't think I understood it the same.
I was thinking the same thing of myself. My passion seems like it just keeps growing.
Yeah.
You know, in the last couple of years, it's just, you know, went crazy. But I didn't have that passion when I was early.
I think a lot of people get the passion early, though, and they get like, it's like getting like the first time you have a girlfriend. It's like, this is awesome.
Yeah. Well, you know? I wish I had a first time. I've still not had one.
But, I don't know that when I started jiu-jitsu, it was rough. You know, like we had some guys that were white belts that had been training for a couple of years and who were good at jiu-jitsu. And here he's wearing a white belt and I'm wearing a white belt and he's kicking my butt. Like, I was like, I remember thinking like, what the heck is a blue belt? Like, how do you get to that level? Cause I'm never going to be this guy.
How are we going to get there?
Have I ever thought about quitting? No, I can't think of like a day where I was like, I never threw a gi away or any, you know, none of that crap or never. Never, occasionally I'll run into a buddy who wants to give me his old gi or something, and that's like, I'm not taking anybody's gi. like, oh, I can't do it anymore. You know, I'll give you my gi. Give me your number. I'll give you my gi. No, I'm not taking your gi. Like, you can't give your gi away. Like,
see, that's awesome. That's the type of guy Byron is, because I would jump all over it.
No, you would. Gary doesn't even wear a gi.
I'd sell it on eBay.
We got to talk about that in a minute too, because, So I've never been like that. I know you have days when, like, probably after I got my blue belt, you know, you get some guy in who's a white belt, and it is important as a blue belt for me to be able to tap out a white belt. And if you can't do it, it's like, man, I suck. Like, yeah, this guy is. He was, you know, a little bit bigger than me, a little bit smaller than me. Doesn't, you know, and man, he was all over me. Some good wrestler in there that I'm not used to dealing with or something as a blue belt. You're disappointed in yourself, you know, but it never made me want to quit. It's just added frustration. I think a lot of blue belts get that. They get like they're going to do something that they couldn't do as a white belt. Now it's going to be easier. Yeah. No, in reality, that white belt's going to try to go after you even harder.
Yeah, I remember getting that belt. Everybody came at you.
Yeah, like, and not to be mean, but you're a blue belt. Defend it. Like, of course the white belts want to tap you out more than they used to want to tap you out as a white belt. Like, it wasn't a big deal when they were white. As a blue belt, you're probably going to get tapped a few times by white belts. Doesn't really freaking matter. Doesn't mean you're getting any worse. It doesn't mean, you're not tired occasionally and they're not full of energy. You know, white belts will wait. They will take an easy round to do a hard round the next round with a blue belt, like, or blue belt with a stripe even. You're like, I got to save energy. I'm getting this blue belt next.
Yeah. Going back to that part you said, have you ever done that?
Probably. Yeah. Like I've watched guys from out of town roll and I'm rolling with somebody and I'm over there watching like, he's good. He's got a good, whatever, you know, triangle. And I know I'm not rolling hard, but I'm watching somebody else roll.
Yeah.
So it's not idiotic. I want them to get the good version of me, not the tired version of me.
Yeah. Yeah. Cause your game, everybody's game wanes a little bit when you're tired.
I got to hijack the interview for a minute here, Gary.
Okay.
It's about me, because I did just get my black belt. You start at the same time.
Yep.
Gary's deal is that he loves the no-gi, and he basically doesn't train with a gi on much. And I'm not going to put anybody else down, but I don't get beat up no-gi as bad by anybody but you in this city. Like, I get the worst no-gi beating from Gary if I try to attack him. Like, if I play it nice and slow and cool, Gary plays nice and slow and cool. But when I sort of pick it up, Gary picks it up way better than me.
I'm a specialist.
Well, his gi game is probably about like my gi game, and it wouldn't involve a lot of gi stuff. But he just doesn't put it on a regular basis. So, and he does. He trains with a handful of buddies, like a real tight-knit group. And so, I mean, So the reason Gary's a purple belt, there's no reason that you're not a black belt today other than you don't train the gi as much. I mean,
Byron, give yourself credit. You're the man. And, you know, but this isn't my interview, but I Byron's always talked to me about passion. And when we were talking about waning, you know, 4 years in probably I've waned. I stopped liking the sport. I really stopped liking it. And I kind of realized, you know, I even talked to Byron, and Byron probably doesn't remember this, but I had a couple of talks with you every now and then on the side at the Wichita Police Academy, and you helped me realize to do what I liked. And I just went and grabbed a bunch of close-knit guys who were all no-gi guys, and we just trained together. Yeah. And that's what I like. But you know, I'll put the gi on again, and I still put it on. Every now and then, I'll always support all my buddies when they have seminars and everything. I'll put it on. It's kind of funny. I put on a gi for a seminar and learn a bunch of gi moves that I'll never use. But it's all about supporting buddies. But hey, that's enough. Okay. That. Let's get
I just
back.
Want to say that yeah. like, you know, yeah. Gary's but, purple belt with the gi, but without the black belt, he's a nice.
I'm a purple belt.
You put that. You start wearing that belt more often, it'll change clothes pretty quick.
I'm to be honest, I was never so happy in my life of seeing somebody get a purple belt. So Byron's been my longest training partner. I started a couple weeks before him. He was one of my first training partners, and because we were the two crappiest guys around,
we
were close to the same size, we always rolled with each other. And Byron got good. He got one move. He got a brick early, and he would tap me out constantly. But when we'd go together, it was almost like trying to pound a square peg into a round hole. Like, we had no concept of jiu-jitsu. We just battled.
We
formed a strong friendship, and you know, it's been a long journey. But okay.
Had to say it though.
Yeah. Speaking of that, my next question, it's funny because I had wrote this question out. I wanted to know who your favorite training partner is.
Well, because Gary's between me and the door, I can't exit the room safely without showing my back. I do.
We don't have geese on right now, so I think we're even.
And Gary just took his shirt off. It's kind of weird.
Well, I'm flexing.
No, yeah, Gary's been a constant like training partner for me, and I do enjoy the aspects that Gary brings. Like, if I don't have to tell you that today I want to roll hard or I want to roll slow, I just do it. I don't know if maybe it annoys you sometimes. I'm trying to kill you. I'm going real fast, or some days I don't really pick it up much. But you seem to just match my speed without even thinking about it.
You know, To be honest, I don't see you slow it down a lot. You like to bring it.
Yeah,
you do. Because like
it's
to
you.
Bring it. Yeah. You know, Byron always brings it. A lot of times, I'm probably considered a slower paced roller.
Are you?
You know, a lot of times I'll do whatever the person's rolling with me, but. You know, I know when me and you go at it, we're going to be tired. But we're going to go at it.
I get.
And the cool thing is, we've tapped each other out numerous times. I don't think I've ever got mad or anything. No. And I hope you're the same way.
Yeah.
You know, it's well, actually, I don't.
I do know when I start, like, if I'm going to be aggressive for like this 5 or 10 minute roll or 20, sometimes we go without a timer and that's just insane. But if I'm going to be like more aggressive before I start, like I know, okay, I'm going to go after Gary today. The odds of me getting tapped out skyrocket. Yeah. Like I'm not playing it safe. I'm going after Gary, and Gary's going to react. And usually, I learned something about you. Just like it just doesn't. I mean,
but what I do is I know if Byron's coming at me, I take the round before off.
You crazy guy. That's where I learned that from. So obviously, you Gary. I mean,
you've got a wide
everybody, over, yeah. Man. I mean, like, yeah. Everybody brings different things. Basically, as long as you're not accidentally elbowing me in the head all the time, you're pretty fun to roll with. Of course, I've got the Jakes at Fox Fitness.
The and Jakes.
The Jakes. Jakes Fox and Jake Smith. I enjoy the any taste of, like, a jiu-jitsu celebrity that comes to the town and teaches a seminar. That's always awesome.
Yep.
And that's for anybody. From Jason on a regular Birch on a regular basis to like the guy that we get once and then, you know, nice to meet you and on your way. Like John Castillo, obviously, and we've got a bunch of really good blue belts and purple belts that give me a good roll every time, but aren't trying to. I don't like the feeling that you're trying to actually injure me, and nobody really does that except for the white belts.
Yeah,
and the white belts that don't try to injure me. Get a funner roll. No, but you could tell like that little bit of that fury's behind there.
Yeah, they're going off everything, but they just not as technical.
But as long as you're trying to roll, I'm having a good time.
Yeah.
And the stinky kids. We don't have a lot of stinky kids. So I'm not big on rolling with stinky people. Yeah.
So. If you could go back and do something over, you know, get a do-over during your journey, is there anything that you could think of that you might...
Man, if Coach would have put me in that third quarter, we'd have take state, man. We'd have take state, no doubt.
Man, Uncle Rico.
Fight a time machine. I need to get those crystals. I can't think of anything that would do any different. No, I guess that's a recurring theme with my jiu-jitsu. At no point in time is anything like a real big deal. Yeah. I'm just going to train. Like, even when I go to compete, either I win or I lose, like, it's not going to affect me training in the next week. Like, I'm going to go train again. Yeah.
What would you say is the best piece of advice a training partner, instructor, or somebody gave you along this journey? Like, is there something that really just sticks out to you?
I think it's not, like, advice, but seeing people enjoy it. Like, for when you first start out, it's a little bit of an intense thing, you know? Like, I'm getting choked. And then, like, you bust out. And it's like, I'm not getting choked. Now I'm going to choke the guy back. Like, that's not, like, that's intense. That's too, I do, like, intense things, like, at work and stuff. But, like, it's too intense to be able to enjoy. And then to see people come in and show, like, a good example of having fun and joking around and enjoying the role and even, like, having a small conversation while you rolled. Like, that was nuts. Like, this guy's talking to me. I'm trying to kill him. Like... He's asking me how my girlfriend is or whatever, you know. I think instead of a thing somebody told me, it's just being able to enjoy it has been big.
And then you've passed that on to everybody else too.
I hope so.
One last question here. I was just wondering, is there like a something, like a favorite memory or something you really laughed at that you, you know, some strange thing that's happened during your career or anything?
I can't, you know what? Give me a second here.
Byron had no clue I was throwing out these questions.
You know, the first thing that comes to mind as I'm talking to Gary right across from me is watching Gary get push kicked across the entire mat and land into the.
You've already brought that one up. But yeah, bring that one up again.
That's funny.
That was. I still tell that story.
You know, I've done plenty of stupid stuff, but I wish I had a good thing. And you think of something funny that we've done? Or?
I don't know.
I make fun of the way Gary stretches sometimes.
Yeah, and he actually did that this last week. Yeah, I'm like the Byron. You know, if I wasn't around, Byron wouldn't have somebody to make fun
of. A lot of my jokes would not be as good, because I know he could take it. I'm not getting mad at me. I don't want to pick on a joke on the new guy. So, same thing with wrist locks, you know. Like, I can't wrist lock the new guy. He'll hate me.
Yeah. You know, I'll say my favorite memory, besides getting push kicked across, you know, these years training with Byron is, I mean, it wasn't even really training. We went to a Bellator match or Bellator event. And on the, we told the story about you pretending like you worked there and sitting everybody down.
Yeah.
And, you know, Byron just is spontaneous. He'll just come out with some crazy stuff and just do it. And it's like, another time we were at local fights, and I remember we look up and there's this perfect place to watch the fights up. It's like a lookout on top of, don't even know how to get there. And Byron's like, hey, yeah, I bet you I can get up there. And we're all like, not a chance. And next thing you know, he walks past all the security and all the people working there and goes back into the honeycombs of all these hallways. And next thing you know, we see him 20 feet up in the air sitting there with a camera guy. Watching the movie or watching the fights, and we're just like, you've got to be.
It was a good view here,
and he's smiling at us, and
it was a good view of the fights.
Yeah, Byron has a good time. He laughs, he jokes, but when he gets on the mat, there he's a freaking beast.
That's one thing. I think I was more shy before jiu-jitsu. Like, I was a little worried that at any point in time somebody might like start kicking my ass. Like,
yeah,
and now like a stranger is not going to kick my ass. Like. Yeah. I mean, yeah, it could, but I don't. That's not a fear in my head. Like, a stranger is somebody I could joke with, I could have fun with, I could talk to, and not worry about getting beat up. Like that's jiu-jitsu. Like, yeah. In the
Speaking
back of, my
of
mind.
That, you know, I know fire department. You guys, you know, deal with some crazy stuff. Have you had to use your jiu-jitsu on the job?
Yeah, I have.
And has it helped out? Yeah. Basically, makes you a better firefighter.
Because,
I mean, you're not just fighting fires. You're going to houses and, you know, to help
medical
people
calls
out, medical calls.
Yeah.
You probably got people going crazy in those calls.
Absolutely. You get, like, PCP, they can't feel pain. So, like...
Sounds like when I try to roll with Byron, he can't feel pain. Or my technique's just not there.
But like, to have the standard response for somebody who doesn't feel pain is to inflict more pain, like people want to hit that person more. Like that's not so like, yeah, I've been okay. First off, the thing that sucks about PCP is they get hot and they end up naked. So suddenly you're doing
naked jiu-jitsu
to where the guy is naked
and sweaty.
And doesn't feel pain and is okay with fighting anybody in the room.
Yeah. And he's sweaty.
And sweaty. Like, so yeah, I've grappled more than a couple guys at work, and they're strong. But the same thing is the positions work, and if they don't know how to get out, and like, I really like knee across the stomach.
Yeah.
At work, I've taken a few guys' backs. Like I'll try to position myself kind of in a smart spot. Like I think they're gonna hit somebody. I don't want to be the guy to get hit, but I will be behind the person ready to jump on them when they hit that first punch. I've done that a couple times. And then it's just, I've never, you know, applied any submission or pressure on anybody at work. I mean, literally, I'm here for the person.
So you're there for the points.
Good. Yeah, I'm a point fighter at work. Nice. Thank you, Carrie. It makes me look bad.
But, That's you know, funny. Going back to that on work, since your teammates, your coworkers know that you're the jiu-jitsu guy, and do you kind of get... Are you, you know, you run up onto a call and there's some big dude who's naked on PCP going crazy. Do they send you first?
We don't. If you're over there going crazy, that's fine. It's when you start to hit people or like, you know, you can pin somebody down who's going to hurt themselves. That's fine.
Yeah.
And the good thing about being naked is there's no weapons involved because everybody has a pocket knife that they have pants on.
You haven't seen some guys naked. No. Sorry, I had to bring that one in.
That was good, man.
We thought it was a weapon. Sorry, I totally ruined this one.
Man, that's one of the that's one of my favorite moments right there. I think sometimes we're too reserved with our jokes.
Yeah, yeah,
that's good.
I was trying to hold that one back, but I couldn't. Sorry,
that's good. I like that's funny, man. Yeah. But I'm there to help the. I mean, that's the same thing with. I'm there to not get hurt and then to. Not let them hurt themselves. Yeah. Like, that's the key.
Yeah, so. That's the key. Not let them hurt themselves and get hurt.
Like, if I was a boxer, I'd have to throw a punch at the guy, and that's not going to work.
Yeah, that's the cool thing about our sport. You can control and subdue somebody.
Yeah, just pin him down. So Gary was generous enough to donate mats to my station. I don't think I ever mentioned that.
Yeah.
We've got
that was my community service.
We've got a section of mats. It was decent size. Like, I don't know how big do you think that thing is. 15 by
probably 15. 14 by 14.
You think so?
Yeah.
You took away a foot.
I don't think it was 15. Yeah, it might have been 15 by 15.
Who knows? It's big enough.
They weren't the greatest mats, though.
So. It's big enough.
Yeah.
It's great enough. Yeah. But all the guys know how to get out. If they're on, I show them, like, okay, how to not get beat up. And I teach them how to get up off their back and why they don't need to turn their back. But so all of them would be hard to pin down and beat up on. Like, that's one of my goals. And then the other thing is I like the neon belly because all these things sound great when you're fighting, you know, like a self-defense situation and I'm going to do this move and that move. And in reality, everybody that I've ever grappled with on the job is somebody who I would want to have gloves on to do medical stuff. Like,
yeah.
Like drug users and the people live hard lives. Like they're not clean people. Like this isn't somebody who I want to grapple with. This is the smelly guy plus a bunch of drugs.
Yeah,
that I'm grappling with now. Yeah. So I like neon belly. I could keep my face away from their face, which is huge.
Yeah,
and but I have control of their body.
Could you imagine though? Like you're talking about that big guy who's you know on PCP. He's got no clothes on. He's sweating. But could you imagine? Like you go. To bear hug him, to take him down. You know, he grabs your wrist and breaks the grip, pulls guard and puts you in a triangle. Like if you ran into a guy, sweaty, naked guy who's on PCP and is a high-level jiu-jitsu guy. That's a scary thought. I have
fears about that, man.
Yeah. Constantly. Well, you will now.
But I do have usually always at least one other guy with me who knows a little bit of jiu-jitsu. Like, I mean, they know I'm not like, as passionate about it as we are, but I expose it to them and they know the basics of, you know, like a nice knee and belly with enough pressure to hold their hips down, control their hands with your hands, and they're stuck.
Yeah, I mean, firefighting's an art. You know, you guys got to work as a team. You guys got to be a close-knit group who all has each other's back, and you work in coordination. And really, I know Byron's starting to laugh because he thinks I'm going somewhere with it. No, I'm really basically just saying, you know, firefighting is an art, you know, being your department, your crew. I don't know what you guys call it, but you all have to work in concert with each other. You know, you have to have each other's back. And that's a good thing, like, too, you're teaching them, you know, neon belly, how to get up, and just enough to, you know, you guys keep each other safe so you can go home to your wife, kids, family, and go home and train.
We did. There's a couple of we did a scenario 2 weeks ago maybe at work, you know, like, just some training. We're always doing training. And you open up the door and like the door of the building, like of a house. And so we're going to go to a medical call. And me and one other guy walk in and it's like split up like it's a house. And one guy is like, oh, I want you to help my girlfriend. She's hurt. And then he goes, I don't know what happened. And he's holding a gun. And so, like, our training, you know, like, it's not just fighting fires and it's I got
like, what are you doing?
My thing, I said he's got a gun. I think I saw it before my partner did, and we just backed out the door right there. Like, it was super easy because later on the scenarios when they did other people, they'd make sure they got into the house to where they could have to actually deal with the person. And but like, we're gone.
Yeah.
I said, we have a little help button we push on our radio. I was like, I'm not pushing that till I'm in the neighbor's yard because that's not going to stop a bullet.
Yeah,
like.
You're waiting for the police department.
I said, I'm gone, and I'm going to be hiding in the bushes. Like, I'm not fighting anybody.
Yeah.
And that's the thing, like, I don't want to fight anybody. Like, even in self-defense, I don't want to fight. I want to survive and a fair fight. No, like, I want to live through this thing.
Yeah.
And if I could avoid it, good. But if, like, it's not going to be... A fight means competition, means a struggle back and forth.
Yeah.
Like, that's not how it should be.
The only way you could have a fair fight... Byron's talking about fair fights. The only way you could have a fair fight with Byron is if you tied both his arms behind his back. And then it would be fair for the normal average person.
Oh, Gary. I don't even know how to respond to that. I'll tell you... Only way you could have a... okay.
Yeah. Sorry, I took us off topic again.
But, so, I mean, we do training like that. And jiu-jitsu is always... It's good to how the body works. So even how to pick up a person off the floor who weighs 300 pounds. Like, I know how to hold... Pick them up and get your hooks better.
Like your jiu-jitsu, you don't just use it in your practice time. You're using it in your job. You can use it at home. You know, I mean, just the fitness aspect too. And like you said, you're more confident as a person, you know. There's so many aspects that make jiu-jitsu not even just fun, but make you a better person.
Yeah. I think you're right.
But I have to admit, this is the interview I probably enjoyed doing the most. You know, it's kind of cool. I had planned this when I found out Byron was getting his black belt. I didn't kind of let him know, but I knew I was going to interview him, and worked out perfect this time. You know, I'm so happy for him. And Byron, once again, I want to congratulate you. Man, you're just an incredible guy, incredible jiu-jitsu practitioner, and a great person all around, which is the most important part.
Of course, incredible guy, incredible. Like, I think I'm an average guy. And I'm a black belt. I'm the me version of a black belt. Like,
Byron, you are not an average guy. I can tell you. And I mean, I'm being serious here.
Regular
and,
guy, man. Like,
you know, I'm not saying you're superhuman or anything, but you're a good guy. Anybody that is a friend of yours would say the exact same thing. You know, you're probably one of the few people, as most people know in jiu-jitsu, a lot of people will talk crap about other people. You'll always hear crap. I don't think I've ever heard one bad thing said about Byron. And I really don't think I have. And most people have had bad
stuff. Because I keep nunchucks in my car, man.
Byron's good with a bow staff.
Yep, and I've joined all the local gangs, man. So who's going to talk crap on anybody who's in all the gangs?
Yeah. Yep.
Put my app in anyway.
Yeah. But that concludes our interview with my co-host, Byron Jabbar.
And maybe it wasn't as awkward as I thought it was going to be, but it was a little awkward for me.
Yeah.
So
Byron just doesn't like to talk about himself.
Time to start the awkward part for Gary.
The what?
Welcome. Before we wrap up the show, we have a new segment of the show.
This is new to me.
Called Ask Gary.
Sweet.
Yes. So, you know, he's pretty knowledgeable about everything. So anytime you have a question you want Gary to answer, we'll put it at the end of the show. It doesn't need to be about jiu-jitsu. It just needs to put Gary in a fun spot.
Okay.
This article is written by Ted. Not article. I won't say article because we see that with him.
Yeah,
this
that started.
Email was written by Ted.
Email?
Ted, yes.
Okay.
So Ted wants to know.
Hi, Ted.
He's a big fan of Gary in particular.
Oh, yes. Actually, my dog's named Ted. Maybe it came from my dog.
Maybe. Yeah. I don't know. There was a lot of paw prints on this thing.
On an email?
Yeah, you wouldn't believe it's covered. So, dear Gary, October is in effect, and all of October things are hitting me like a ton of bricks.
Ooh, well said. Yeah.
Thank you for that. Nice job, Ted. He goes on here. He talks about a lot of October things, orange leaves, Cassandra colors. He says, the thing I don't like about October is Halloween. I get scared during Halloween. Gary, these kids come to my house, they take my candy, they are dressed up in masks, and I don't know who they are, and it's scary for me. What could I do to not be scared on Halloween?
Well, Ted, first of all, I'd like to thank you for sending in your question to the Ask Gary segment. You know, I really appreciate the question. But what I would tell you is, you know, first of all, sorry that you're scared of these goblins that are coming to the door and taking your candy, but there's a real easy solution. What you need to do is turn off your lights, shut your garage door, pull your shades down, go watch TV in your basement, and normally there should be an NBA basketball game on that night because basketball starts about the same time as Halloween. And don't answer your door if anybody knocks on it. And you won't have any issues.
That's it right there. See, that's why they want to know. Questions to Gary. He'll give you the
easy solution. And I will tell you, I've done it before.
So we sit down there, do you eat candy?
No, I don't. I'm not a big candy guy.
I would be eating the candy that I was supposed to give out to the kids.
Yeah, yeah. You could just go buy a bunch of candy and put it in a bowl and just eat it yourself.
Can I really?
Yeah, you could do that. No, I'm talking to Ted.
Oh.
Yeah.
Thanks, Ted. We appreciate the email. Yep. The email is bjjbrick@gmail.com. Send your questions, articles, quotes, whatever you want to say to us. Questions for Gary, always.
Yep. And don't forget, if you're in Wichita, Kansas, send us an email. Stop by and roll with the new black belt, Byron Jabara, and his partner in crime, me.
Yep. It was funny during the Monday morning or whatever. One of the guys is like, I finally got to see who Gary is. I'm like, are you serious? You didn't know Gary? He's like, no, he's one of the regulars at Fox Fitness.
Oh, that's cool.
And I go, how'd you know it was him? He goes, because of the patch. Like, it looks like Gary on the logo.
The cool thing is, I don't even have a patch on my gi.
No, but he recognized your face from the logo. And I go, did you roll with him? He goes, no. I go, oh, but then you should have grabbed him and rolled with the guy.
So, that's awesome.
If
that's
you recognize Gary, he'll be happy to roll with you.
Yeah. So I'm kind of a celebrity in my own mind.
If you'd like to get a weekly email about the podcast, go to the bjjbrickweb.com and there's a place you can put your email in and we'll send you an email once a week. So we're showing you what's up and what we got coming your way. We also have a Facebook page and a Twitter page, Twitter account, Twitter
Nest. Whatever.
I don't know what it is.
We're not great at Twitter.
We're not that, yeah.
So we're still learning.
Like I said, we're giving away free gi patches to a five-star review, funny five-star reviews. We'll go ahead and talk to you about that right now. Gary, this is every week, man. Every week we try to get a funny review to read and to bring on the show and share with everybody.
Yeah, and it just hasn't been happening. I mean, it's kind of sad.
It is sad. You know, nothing makes us more happy when we get something that's funny written by one of the listeners. And you know, they make fun of us. They do sometimes.
It's good to make fun of us sometimes.
One guy thought that we were a podcast about brick making.
Yeah, and another guy talked about, you know, the brick and microphone choke.
Yeah. And one review talked about us as man dancers, dancing with other sweaty men, and interviewing even more sweaty men. But you know, it's sad, but they're hard on us, and that's good for us to have jokes about us.
Another person said we sounded like a guy on Family Guy.
So how could they help us, Gary?
You know, just less than 10 minutes out of their life.
One time.
And you know what they're going to get in return for that? They're going to get a patch mailed to them. A BJJ brick patch that they can wear on their gi.
Yeah, or sew it to a t-shirt. We don't care.
Yeah, or just carry it.
Put it in your wallet, and when somebody asks for your ID, they'll see it and they'll know how cool you are.
Yeah, I mean, sew it to your forehead.
But we're just, help this little podcast here. We like our funny reviews. We do like any five-star review, obviously. But take the time. Take the heart.
Yeah, like we said, just less than 10 minutes of your life.
And make fun of us.
Yeah.
Make it funny.
Yeah.
We'll read it online.
Yeah. And I mean, we take these to heart. Like, we can't figure out which one of us sounds like the guy in Family Guy, but we've been trying not to sound like him.
Giggity. Yeah. Giggity, Gary.
So please, just please, take less than 10 minutes and give us a review. Make fun of us.
Yeah.
And in return, we will send you out the patch.
But after you send that, make that review, copy it, paste it to bjjbrick@gmail.com, and let us know that you made the review, and then we'll be able to send it to the right person.
because we want to make sure our product gets in the hands of the right person.
Yeah, we don't want any of the non-reviewers, the ones that don't tease us, to be aware of this. Yeah,
not everybody can get teased, but we want to be.
Yeah. So,
please, we beg you.
Guys, well, thanks for listening to a little bit of my story, and I tried to get a little bit of Gary's story in there too. Trust me, he's got as much as I do. Been a pleasure serving the community here. Been listening and want to continue to do hard work. It's been an honor to get a black belt this year. It's kind of funny that we've been podcasting for a year and I got my black belt on that day.
Yeah, so that's kind of neat. That was crazy. I thought about that afterwards. Like, we didn't talk about it that day, and actually, I don't think Byron even knew until I told him today, right before the podcast.
Yeah, I didn't really realize
that. Because I thought that was special. And it was not planned. I was like, we were actually planning on doing something like on our one-year anniversary of this. And, you know, as one thing came to another, we never got around to it. But, hey, this is better than anything that could have happened. So congrats, right, buddy.
We'll be back next week with another show, and help you guys out with the Jiu-Jitsu journey.
Thank you for listening, my friends. We appreciate it very much.
Thank you for listening. I hope you find the time today to roll. After all, the best way to get better at Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu is to do Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu.
Here is another segment of unnecessary censorship. I don't... The first part of the question wasn't the same. I don't think it was. I don't think I understood
I was thinking the same thing of myself. Seems like it just keeps growing.
Yeah.
You know, in the last couple of years, it's just, you know, went crazy. But I didn't have that when I was early.
I think a lot of people get the early, though, and they get like, it's like getting like the first time you have a girlfriend. It's like, this is awesome.
Yeah. Well, you know? I wish I had a first time. I've still not had one.